Today I want to talk to you guys about microclimates, what they are, why you need to know about them, and how they can help you or cause you a lot of problems. That's coming up next on The Urban Farmer. Right now I'm standing in one of my backyard plots. In fact, it's my next door neighbor's plot that's in a sense connected to our home base. And this is in fact a microclimate. And so what does that mean? A microclimate means almost literally what those two words combined mean. A microclimate. So it's a small climate. It's a different climate than just outside the general area. For example, right here, I have a south aspect, so right towards the camera is facing the south. So turn around this way, that's the south. To my left here, this is the western side, there's a building. And there's two kind of microclimates happening on this site. And it's important to understand this for a couple reasons. The first one is, there's going to be a slightly different variation in what the average temperature is here, also the light availability. And that can cause you problems, and it can also work to your benefit as long as you understand what you're getting into. So in this case, I'm facing the south, but I've got a shade structure on my western side. What that means is, generally speaking, for most of the season, so for those of us in the northern hemisphere, where for the most part the sun is going to be in the southern hemisphere, this is going to be a little heat pocket. So from the spring and the fall and the winter, the sun is going to be in this horizon. So on my winter solstice, my sun is setting almost by that second tall building, not this one here, this one over here. My sun is setting over there, and my sun is rising just by this tree at my winter solstice. At my summer solstice, it's extreme. My sun is actually setting over here in the northwestern sky, and it's rising in the northeastern sky. So for the spring, winter, and fall, the sun is for the most part down there, which gives me an advantage, meaning that this is a little bit of a light funnel and a heat funnel. Since the sun is back there most of the time, heat is trapped here. In the summertime, I actually get a relief from the sun, which can work to my advantage, but it can also work to your disadvantage. In this case, it does work to my advantage, in the sense that at the hottest point of the day, around 4:30, 4 o'clock, the sun is coming behind this building, and then these plants actually get a bit of relief, so they get a bit of shade. And this is summer squash. Maybe in some other climates you might want to have more sun for your squash, but I am in a very hot, dry desert climate in the summer. So I like to have a little bit of shade in the afternoon. That means that later in the day we can sometimes go and pick them because we get relief from the sun. So that's a good thing. Let's go look at another microclimate. So here in my front yard, it's another type of microclimate, but it's slightly different. So my house is on the south side, and so this plot is on the north side of the house, and it presents some challenges. So I'll give you a little bit of an assessment of what else is around me. I also have, my neighbor has a really big blue spruce tree here, and in a way that tree functions in the exact same way as that building did on the last plot. It provides shade in the late part of the afternoon, but only really around the summer solstice. Once the sun starts to recede back into the sky, like it will be now because we're in late July, it's not going to be causing much shade. It's really only for a couple weeks that it would actually cast shade on here at the late afternoon. But my house being on the northern side, or on the southern side of this plot, means that I'm going to have a shadow. There's going to be a shadow cast on this plot for almost the majority of the season, at least for half of it. So I'm just going to step back here and show you. So there's about 8 different beds here of varying sizes. For the most part, so from say in my growing season, which is really effectively, you know, late March to early November, half of this plot will be in shade. So the first 3 beds are in shade. When I start planting this plot, I start from the edge, which is the furthest in the most amount of sun, which would be the furthest north away from the house. I'll start planting those beds and I'll make my way back as the sun comes high in the sky. So this closest bed to my house, this bed doesn't get planted until maybe 3 weeks into the summer solstice because it's still in shade, just because it's a close proximity to the house. So the reason why this is so important is for urban farmers who are farming in lots and are near buildings, you need to understand how that climate can help you or be detrimental to you, but how you can use it and maneuver around the potential challenges with how the shade falls. You always need to think about where your sun rises and sets at each time of the season. That's the thing that I'm looking for the most when I go into a new plot of land and I want to establish a garden site there. The most important part is understanding where your south aspect is and what kind of microclimate you can establish there that will benefit you. If you have shade structure, if you have too many shade structures in your southern area, whether it be to the east and west of the south, that's going to cause a problem for a longer period of time in your season, especially if you're in the northern hemisphere. If you're close to the equator or in the southern hemisphere, well then if you're in the southern hemisphere, it's just the exact opposite. Just replace my south for your north. But if you're near the equator, it won't matter as much. Whereas in the summertime, shade obstructions aren't going to make as much of a difference. So shade obstructions that are on your western side or on your eastern side, they're not going to matter as much because you're still getting so much sunlight throughout the day and the sun is changing its degree, the angle of, that it's at. So it's not really going to be as detrimental to you. But you really do need to understand how these microclimates can benefit. I want to give you one more example, just right here in my neighbor's backyard. I don't really grow peppers for commercial production. I mostly just grow these for myself. But these peppers are a perfect example of the benefit of a south exposure microclimate. They're right up against this wall. I'm going to get a heat benefit from this building. So sun is going to come in from the south and it's going to actually bounce off this building, reflecting more light on these plants. But because there's less wind coming in from the north on these, it's also going to have a heat benefit as well. So these plants will thrive more on against this south-facing building than they would anywhere else. They'll also be more protected from frost when that starts to happen, because when frost settles, it won't settle as much in this zone because there is a sort of a heat pocket here. There's a radiant heat in this area. One thing that will happen too with a south-facing microclimate is if you're against a brick wall and that brick wall holds heat, you can actually have a quite extreme microclimate. And I've seen some growers growing lemon trees in Canada by establishing them against stone walls or brick walls that are facing the south because those walls hold so much heat. And in fact, they'll actually hold more heat per capita on the shoulder season when the sun is further down and it's actually getting more straight on sun than in the summer when the sun's higher in the sky. Because for myself, let's just pretend this is a brick building. My sun right now in July is still rising over there and setting over there. This wall doesn't actually get that much direct sunlight in the sun or in the summer, but in the spring, the fall, and even the winter, it will because the sun is further down in the sky. I hope that helps. Love to hear your guys' story of unique microclimates. There's so many out there, and I'm sure there's all kinds of stories out there. So leave your comments and questions below. If you guys want to see more stuff like this, please hit the subscribe button right now. Like and share these videos with your friends. Check out my online course, ProfitableUrbanFarming.com, my book, TheUrbanFarmer.co. And if you'd like to make a donation to the show, it is much appreciated and always welcome. You can do that at TheUrbanFarmer.co/support. Okay, see you soon.